The Comic Book Jerk Show is brought to you in part by SnapPal.com
and BigOldBoxOfStuff.com.
And Drac and Aaron are also big supporters of the KY. What was it again, Drac? What's the name of that?
It's the Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness.
So what?
The Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness.
We got a great show for you guys this week. Drac got some interviews with Z Nation, and I run around with Mike and Ming from the Comic Book Men, and even got an interview with Greg Grunberg about the upcoming Geeking Out show that he's done. So are you
now, ready? Is it Grunberg or is it Grunberg?
It could be Grunt or it could be Grun. I guess it just depends on what place you're from. So it could be a Southern or it could be a Western, Middle East. I mean, it could be Grunberg. You know, it could be Grunberg.
Middle East would be my Grunberg.
Grunberg. Maybe Grunberg. You know. So what time is it, Drac?
Well, it's time for this fat guy and this little skinny dude to sit around and smoke some cigarettes and talk about stuff that nobody really cares about. Oh, and it's also time to kick that music.
Trolls, don't adjust your keyboard. You're about to watch the Comic Book Jerk Show.
From the flamers and dudes who were trolling the fans, the midichlorian masterminds concocting a plan. Before he had an emporium of Endorian elves, and he was complaining about those movies starring Christian Bale. Anime's manga mastermind returned again to reboot his new show with all his geeky friends. Like the difference in Wookiees and Tribbles and Kibbles and Bits, the story comes together like a reductor twist from Harry Potter. Or maybe it's worse, you might even curse the jerk for reminding you that everything's worse. In the back of your mind, he says, but you never could, and you never should, and you never would, but he could. So listen up, troll, and let's go. It's time to sit back and watch a Comic Book Jerk Show.
All right, what's up, dude?
I gotta say, man, I'm loving this new format. Not only can we do this live, but people can see us and make fun of us all they want to now.
Oh, so we're going live then, right?
Yeah, we're live. Every time we do this show now, it's live, basically. Whether it's uploaded today or tomorrow, it's still live.
So, I got you.
So this was a very unique and kind of crazy weekend at the Lexington Comic and Toy Convention for 2016. And we promised,
it sure was.
We promised a follow-up show, so this is the official follow-up show for the Lexington Comic and Toy Convention. And I got to say, it was actually jam-packed this year. Like, there were so many people that the second day of the con, I got stuck in the traffic for 3.5 hours. Finally made it to the con and couldn't even get into the con floor because it was just so big. Like, there was so many people there that I was just like, yeah, I think it's time to go sit in Drac's hotel room for a little bit and order a pizza. You got any interesting stories, sir?
But definitely, if you're going to have a problem at a con, you know, business standpoint, that's definitely a good problem to have. I mean, problems are problems, don't get me wrong. But the problem is there's too many people showing up. That's a good problem to have.
Oh, that's a great problem to have. I mean, the more people, the better, dude. And, hey, you actually got to do some crazy fun stuff this year, man. Like, tell us about the experience with old DJ, the rock star DJ Trey.
Oh, DJ Trey went up to the DJ booth during the VIP party, and I just said, hey, man, let me bust the flow. Let me drop the mic. And he said, what do you want to do? I said, since we're keeping it old school, let's do a little old House of Pain.
Did everybody jump?
I had all my fellow geeks jumping around, that's for sure.
Did you say, get out your seat and jump around?
No, I said, get your ass up and jump around.
It's always a crazy experience, man. I'll tell you what, like, the funniest part for me was when you were doing the costume contest, I had to run around and try to find the cameraman, because usually we do this as a team, or I have somebody else to hold the camera or something. Like last year, I couldn't get a hold of you at all, so Justin filled in. So Justin was working on a huge costume, and if you know, Justin is actually the cosplay kid, if you guys aren't familiar. Cosplay kid comes in, jumps in sometimes with the podcast, but he had Blue Eyes White Dragon this year, didn't he? Like he had a suit that was just huge. Like, you know, I didn't get a chance to see what happened with that, but as I was walking through the hall to the costume contest, I noticed the death of Blue Eyes White Dragon.
Yeah.
I wish you, hey, probably on the actual podcast, we'll have him back and actually talk about that. But do you know what time it is, Drac? Because every podcast, we've got to do this. Do you know what time it is?
I believe it's about time for Funko of the Week.
That's right. It is Funko Pop of the Week of
Funko
the year.
Funko Pop of the Week.
Month, of the day. Of the leap year. So what do we got? What do we got for him today, Drac? You're looking at me like, Funko Pop of the Year, the day of the month.
Well, being that they just released last week, I thought, and I had a good look. I only bought two, and I got two different ones. I didn't get duped. So Hot Topic did another mystery box, and it was the Deadpool mystery box.
Mystery Pop with Deadpool!
And in those, you had a chance to get one of three pops, and that was Solo, the green, Full Killer, the blue, and then the Chase, which was the Purple Terror. And I pulled Full Killer. That was the first one I pulled.
Oh, he's Full Killer. Let's get a close-up on that.
Now, it's cool and everything because they changed the name, and the color scheme is cool. But come on, why do we keep the same old-ass mold?
Well, I mean, it's funny you mention that because if you actually read the comic book, each one of the Deadpools that's working with Deadpool's little group are all packing different weapons. Some of them's fatter, some of them's skinnier, some of them's buffer, some of them's not buff. So it's kind of odd that they would choose to use the same exact mold for each one and just color them different. And it's kind of like the Batman.
It does remind me a lot of the 75th anniversary Rainbow Batman set. You're definitely right. And then the second one that I pulled, and you know me, man, I'm all about my chases. Good old Chase race. I pulled that Purple Terror.
You had to pull the Purple Terror. That was the second one you opened?
That was the second one I opened, so I still don't have Solo yet to complete the set. But
well, I'm sure he'll be easy to find. I mean,
there's a lot of people on the Kentucky League of Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness that have been posting on for
two. How hard is that to say three times fast, dude? Like, how fast can you say it, Kentucky?
Let's take the challenge here. Let's see. All right,
here's the challenge.
Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness.
Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. See, I get to the four time and I'm done. I can't do it. So I've brought a couple of pops for my week's Funko Pop of Awesomeness. If I can find them, I can find one of them. Where's the other one here?
Well, you need to keep your stuff more organized, man.
I'll tell you what, man, with what I've got going on in this production room, there's no telling what's going on. I honestly still have the pops from previous podcasts, man, honestly. But for my Funko Pops of the Week, I've got not one, but two Flashes. I've got the Blue Lantern Flash. I guess this would be like the set or something similar to that. I like this.
And yeah, the metallic.
Yeah, I really do like the metallic, man.
Those are nice.
It seems like there might have been like a weird factory error on his chest, but I mean, it's still cool regardless.
Right.
I mean, I always like the metal pops more than I like just like the other pops, but you know, it's...
Yeah, I'm a big fan of the metallics as well.
It's kind of weird. I'm still after that Superboy, man. That Superboy is going to elude me probably my entire time of collecting, but
Is that your Great White Buffalo?
That might be my Great White Buffalo, man. I mean, that might be the one that I search and hunt for that... Is like a Kevin Costner movie or something, man. Dances with the Wolves or something.
White Buffalo.
But I don't know. It seems like these are like really, really cool pops because I don't know. They got the paint perfect on this one. Like there's
Great
no smudges.
Buffalo.
What'd you say, Drac?
Great White Buffalo.
Great White what?
Great White Buffalo.
But anyways, that pretty much ran.
Apparently
up.
You've never seen Hot Tub Time Machine.
No, I don't remember that part, but that concludes Funko Pop of the Week. Now, since we're getting into Funko Pop of the Week, it is it is one of those times where we break out an interview from somebody very special at the con that you got this year.
Oh, yeah?
You gonna tell us about it? Or?
Oh, are we talking about Mr. Steven himself? Mr. Heroes Realm, open till 7. For everybody that's members of the Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness, they're very familiar with who this gentleman is. And I just want him to tell me a little bit about the store. So, yeah, we had a nice little chat and put it on camera and said, hey, it's going on to the podcast. Steven's a really great guy, and he gave a pretty funny interview.
Yeah, he definitely did a pretty funny interview. So let's go ahead and see if we can't check it out here and see what's going on with that. Now, he did come up with a really cool... I don't know if... Did he come up with the sign or... Like, who come up with the new logo that we have?
Well, I know he's the one that had it made, so I'm not sure the whole story on it. I don't know if he touches in the interview or not. But let's go ahead and roll that beautiful bean footage.
Roll that beautiful bean footage.
Hey, guys, what's going on? It's Drac once again, and I'm here with Steven from Heroes Realm. What's going on, Steven?
We are at Lexington Comic Con having a blast, selling everything.
Selling all your wares.
Doing our best to sell everything we can. And we're trying to sell everything that's not nailed down, basically.
So basically what you're trying to tell me is you don't want to have to pack this stuff back up and take it back, right?
I don't want to take anything back. Right so, now, it's deals galore happening.
Well, so we know you got the booth here, but yes. We also know that you have a really, really kick-ass comic book store. So tell us a little bit about Heroes Realm.
We've got Heroes Realm over on Paris Pike behind the brand new Popeyes in Lexington. We're open till 7 o'clock, as most everybody knows by now.
Open till 7.
We have comics, toys, games, Magic the Gathering every Friday night. What's up? Everything. We have everything.
And we're going to have to steal a few and put them into the post-production, but this guy is the master of the selfie sundae.
It's a thing I do.
And for y'all that don't know, Steven is also a big supporter of something that's very close to our hearts. He's a proud member of the Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. You see us talk about our Funko of the Week every week? Well, this is the group that helped inspire that. Steven, I just want to say thank you for the interview, brother. Absolutely. And we'll definitely be coming out to Heroes Realm to see you soon.
All
right. Anything else you want to say to anybody?
I love everybody.
Steven loves everybody. Everybody.
He loves everybody. I'm telling you, that's
everybody.
That's definitely one of the funniest interviews that I think I've seen in a while. But you know, this is the part of the actual podcast where we talk about the Lexington Comic and Toy Convention some more. Are you ready? Because we got some
Lexington Comic and Toy Convention.
Yep. 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention. Blah 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 blah. Which I didn't know till this con that Lexington Comic and Toy Convention actually now has their hands in the Derby City Con in Louisville. So in
hell
June,
yeah.
In June, they might need a moderator and might even need somebody to run their costume contest or something like that. You never know. Hey, you've got Slimer over your
Slimer's rainbow. Back, man.
Slimer is back. But
there's something strange in your neighborhood.
Who you gonna call? Greg Grunberg. So this was...
Tell us about Greg Grunberg.
Let me tell you about Greg, man. Greg was the craziest interview that I think I've ever had, just because, like, out of all the interviews I've done, he's got, like, more energy than Doug Jones had. Like, Doug Jones had some energy, but Greg was all about it, dude. Like, you can tell right from the bottom of his soul that he's a true geek, a true nerd, a true fan. Like, he's one of them dudes that's like, he's got his hand in about everything, from a cooking show to a show with Kevin Smith, to being in Star Trek, to being in Star Wars, to being in Heroes. I mean, like, you know, we had a pretty interesting conversation. We'll check it out and try to...
Now, before we roll this is the part where I need to throw the disclaimer up and let everybody know
from here on out,
from this interview out, this is no longer a PG-rated show. So if there are children in the room, they may want to leave.
Yeah, because Greg gets a little bit raunchy with his interview, but I was fine with that because it's not often that you get interviews where a guy's actually speaking like a real person, like everybody else is like.
Right, absolutely. Not saying anything against the guy on it. It's just you know, we want to throw the disclaimer out there because we do know that, you know, a lot of people that are affiliated as far as watching the show do have families. So if you're watching with your family, now would be the time to send the kids to bed.
And this is a YouTube show, so it's a little bit different from our podcast where we will talk about the sexual orientations of Batman and, you know, we will dive deep into weird stuff and say weird stuff. We try to tone it down a little bit for the Comic Book Jerk show, but, you know, it might be okay because I think we may only have one F-bomb, two F-bombs. I don't know. Good, but let's
But we don't know how many I'm going to drop for nights over with either.
No, who knows? Because, I mean, I actually have a couple of Budweiser here, so you never know.
Now, wait a minute. The first one was a Budweiser. Now you're drinking a Bud Light Select?
Yeah. See, I got Budweiser and then a Bud Select to chase it down with. So, let's go ahead and check out this interview.
Yeah. What's up? It's the Comic Book Jerk here at the 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention with Greg Grunberg.
What's up? Yeah, you're such a jerk, dude.
No, I mean,
You're the biggest jerk I know in the best way possible.
Yeah. Well, sometimes there's these movies that just suck, and then there's some that are good, but...
Yeah, but Comic Book Jerk, man.
What do you think your worst comic book movie you ever seen was?
Oh,
without hurting anybody's feelings.
Well, I don't know if it's a comic book movie. It was called,
It's a gizmo?
Oh, man. It was called Miracle Mile. I don't know if anybody saw that. It wasn't a comic book movie.
It must have been so bad I didn't see it.
It was so bad, and yet J.J. Abrams, who's my good friend, he loved that movie. That's our, like, you know, we go head-to-head against each other. And then I've got this show with Kevin Smith now, and in the, you know, in Geeking Out, it's the two of us talking about new movies and stuff. We talk a lot about superhero stuff. And, like, Mad Max, for me, did you love Mad Max?
Oh, I love Mad Max. The new one was awesome, especially in 3D.
Yeah, I mean, visually, but there was no story. There was nothing.
It didn't need a story. It was just straight up.
You and Kevin... I wanted just a little bit more. I mean, it was incredible. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. Absolutely, like, mind-blowing. When you can put something on screen now that you've never seen before, like, how can you possibly do that? Like, you walk around here, or you think of, like, this graphic novel that I've got coming out. It's a good segue, right?
I have this. Let's segue right into this.
Yeah, so this is a thing called Dream Jumper, right? So I thought of this. My kid had a dream, nightmare. He woke up. I was, you know, cuddling him and going, hey, go back to sleep. And he said, what was it? And he said, I was jumping in and out of my friend's nightmares like a superhero and helping them through their worst fears. And I was like, that's the coolest thing ever. And I thought, there's no way. There's got to be something else. And they're just themes that repeat themselves, you know. So, you know, to put something on screen like Mad Max, it's so fucking original. That's cool.
Was this one of those moments where you're like, hey, JJ, you want to make a movie?
JJ wrote the foreword on it. And
see that it says A Great Ride by J.G. Abrams.
Yep. And we're hoping to make a movie at Paramount. So we'll see. But it hasn't come out yet. So in June, and also Free Comic Book Day, it'll be available in all the comic book stores for like three chapters of it. They're giving it away.
So with the new show you got with Kevin Smith, is it going to be on AMC?
Or? It'll be on AMC after Fear of the Walking Dead. It's the two of us geeking out about all the stuff that
have,
we all
have
love.
Have you shot anything yet, or is it still like in the works of like test footage? And-
No. We shot a pilot, and it got picked up. We're doing 9 episodes, and we're going to be going around to a lot of cons. He's up shooting The Flash right now. He's directing.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go up there and shoot something with him, and he's... You know, I'm going to do some stuff tomorrow here, walking around, same thing you're doing, but with other people, you know, interviewing people. So it's cool.
So, like, whenever you got an opportunity to be in the next Star Wars movie, like, is that because you were friends with JJ and he was like, well, we'll throw
For sure. I mean, everybody in the world wants to be in that movie. So, yes, the second that he said he was going to do it, you know that the first phone call came from me and I was like, all right, dude, you're my best friend. What am I playing? And I just begged him and you know, he's the greatest.
Did you have the same reaction that Kevin says that he had when he stepped on a Millennium Falcon where you get a little tear in your eye?
Yes. I was at craft service staring at donuts with a tear in my eye. But he had that visceral reaction that we all did. Me too. When I stepped on the stage, man, I mean, imagine you grew up with it and you step on the stage. Or, I mean, imagine that's you. I mean, what? Yeah. What?
And everybody was like, what character are you playing and what are you doing? Like, who is. Who
I mean, I got playing? To do this. I love that we have visual aids.
Yeah.
I got to do that. That's crazy. That's every kid's dream, man. So I'm, I'm just so thrilled. It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing.
So do you get to come back for the sequel, or?
I don't know. I don't know. Everything is so secretive, and, you know, I hope I get to play this character again. There's going to be a lot of movies, and we'll see. I'm not allowed to talk about it, but. Yeah.
Let's talk about something you can talk about, like Heroes Reborn.
Yeah.
I'm going to go ahead and spoil a little bit of it. When your character came out and he was the villain, That broke my heart, dude.
It was cool, though, right?
No, that was a total shock to my system, dude.
Saying goodnight to Henry Winkler. I mean, what's better than that?
That is amazing. When Henry Winkler comes up and blows you kisses.
Oh, my God. Henry's an old friend of mine, and, yeah, he's the greatest. The fact that we're sitting next to each other, it's like almost like me and JJ shooting a movie together. 100,000
views right now. Yeah.
I know. So, wait, my room tomorrow morning. I'll call you before.
I'm surprised you're not taking your pictures and trying to make paper airplanes just to aggravate him all day. Like
throw it at the Fonz. I love it. Dude, that guy is in every Happy Madison movie. Henry Winkler is a national treasure. Yeah. Absolute national treasure. I love him.
But back where we was talking, dude, the heartbreaking moment where your character is now a villain. Like, was that something like you pushed for or something that was in the script? You was like, yeah, I'll totally do it. Let's do it. Or
yeah, I mean, they call, you know, Tim called me and said, would you want to come back? I'm like, absolutely. I'd love to play this character again. Remember, those years and years off. And to get a second chance. And then he said, I have some interesting news for you. I think ultimately, it's redeemable because I'm protecting my family, Matt Parkman. But a lot of people didn't like the fact that I was evil. They just didn't like it.
I didn't like it. It broke my heart, man. But I was thinking maybe he'll turn at the end like most villains do. Maybe he'll turn it good in the end. But
yeah, I mean, well, you know, we're not going to get a chance. Unfortunately, it is over.
I'm for the villains, baby.
Yeah, you're for the villains. See, there you go. Awesome.
I definitely dug it, man. And I really appreciate the work that you did on Big Ass Spider, man.
Thank you.
Because that, to me, is like the cult classic. Like, if you ain't seen Big Ass Spider, you ain't seen it.
Another visual aid coming your way right here. Come on. Big Ass Spider. If you haven't seen it, it's in the vein of Sharknado, but it's so much better. It's a really, really fun movie.
Well, before we take off here, is there anything you'd like to plug or anything else you'd like to throw out there that you might be doing that you're allowed to talk about?
This is a kind of a cool spoiler thing. I'm not breaking it here, but I'm in the new Star Trek Beyond, which is very cool. So that's something that people should look out.
You're getting into the best of both worlds. You're in both universes.
Dude, I have a huge mug at home that says you have to trek before you war. And that just says it all right there.
He's also in a galaxy far, far away.
Exactly. And I'm on Comic Jerk, man.
Yeah, it's definitely cool to actually get a chance to talk to you, man.
Oh, man, thank you for asking me to be on the show.
And from comicbookjerk.com, check out the podcast, check out the website, check out Greg.
Yeah, baby.
Well, I mean, just the Fonz, dude.
How do you do
you're
that?
You're sitting there, you're interviewing somebody, and the Fonz walks up and starts blowing kisses to you. What do you do? How do you react to that? It's like, you're crashing my interview, but you're freaking Henry Winkler.
So technically, does that mean that we got our first official interview with Henry Winkler, too? Where he was like, he was pretty much like, good night. And then he'd come back around and say,
well, we heard him say it starts at 9 o'clock.
Yeah, so something went down at 9 o'clock because Winkler wasn't there on Saturday.
So how do you know you wasn't there at 9 o'clock on Saturday?
I wasn't there at 9 o'clock on Saturday, but he wasn't there on Sunday. So I was there all day Sunday. But how wild is that, man? What do you do when somebody taps you on the shoulder and you turn around and it's the freaking Fonz, dude? Because literally like put his hands on you to blow kisses. The Grunberg. It was like, what is going on here? Like, I was like, all right, I don't care what you do, Drac. If you don't turn around and get him on camera, I'm going to go nuts. I'm going to freak out. And then,
but you don't understand, man. The Fonz touched me. And not in a bad way.
No, not at all. He blew kisses behind your shoulder. So it was like you got a little bit of his flying kisses.
Essence.
His essence was brushing against your shoulder, dude.
Yeah, wow. It's like, so, and I totally got extra cool points that weekend, so.
Dude, you totally got cool points. I wish I was holding the camera at that point. I was like, I was about to just set my microphone down and be like, hey, Winkler, give him a hug or something and get kicked in the face. Like, could you see the Fonz being like, whoa!
Going all Danielson on you, man. Jumping the shark right in your face.
That's the first time I've actually watched that interview since we shot it, and I had no freaking idea that I had those stupid glasses on my head, dude. Like, I had no idea the entire interview that I had these stupid glasses on my head, man. But I'm telling you what, Grunberg was really cool, man. Like, I got some footage of him. I come back Sunday and talked to him a little bit and showed him my petition to get Kevin Conroy on Mallrats 2, which is footage that I'm actually kind of afraid to show anybody because it got such weird reviews. Like, Greg said it would be, Kevin would love it. But Mike Zapcic and Ming Chen said, oh, man, that's too much. That's, you know, that's one of those moments where you just, you stepped in too much. You can't do that.
Which is what I told you as well.
Yeah. Everybody seems to have took it the wrong way. Like I was portraying it like I was a Jason Mewes. You know how Jason and all the films, he's always just like out of this world, like just beyond, like a douche. And that's what I was trying to portray. You know, I was trying to be that guy that, you know. I love Kevin Smith movies, don't get me wrong, but I don't want people to take my petition to get Kevin Conroy as anything but, you know, a joke for Babylon, you know, because that's essentially what I was. But coming up on the next topic, you got an awesome interview with Keith Allen.
That's right. And for y'all that don't know who Keith Allen is, he's the Murphy on the hit sci-fi TV show Z Nation. Now, Z Nation... You know, you have The Walking Dead that comes on AMC, and imagine it to be kind of George A. Romero-ish, you know, more serious zombie movie. So Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead.
But funnier, way, way funnier.
Well, and then you have the series, the Return of the Living Dead series, which started off originating in Louisville.
That's true.
Now, if you was to take that and make a TV show out of it, that would be Z Nation. Because it's so hilarious, and it's just, it's funny as it can be, but yet there's zombies everywhere.
There's a serious undertone behind it, but unlike Walking Dead, where it's just like, you're at the edge of your seat, and you're just like, you know.
Show right here will have you in the floor rolling.
Yeah, it'll have you rolling, but it also has that serious tone where it's like you're more interested in it. It's almost like, you know, for me, it's kind of like watching Arrow, and it's got that serious undertones, and then watching The Flash, and it's kind of got that quirky, like, there's hints of funniness, but it's still got that underlying storyline to it. And Z Nation, to me, is like, it's probably the best thing I've seen on sci-fi since Battlestar Galactica, because Battlestar Galactica was pretty cool, but to take a zombie show that you're, like, really invested in, like Walking Dead, and, like, you just can't miss an episode, to Z Nation, which is a thing where you're like, I would rather the whole series finish and then go back and watch every single episode because it's better back to back. I mean, it's not that way with Walking Dead. It's like if you miss an episode 1 week, you're screwed because everybody's already spoiled it for you. When you watch it, you're not really surprised. But Z Nation is always a surprise, man, right from the beginning and then like right to the end too. So it's always
it never ceases to amaze me how they push the envelope in this show.
And what blows me away about this interview is like he's serious on the show and he's like, you know, he's but when you meet this guy, he is the most charismatic dude. He's so full of life and full of energy and smiles. He's like the dude that you're like, you need your own show where you need like, I don't know what it is about Keith Allen, but he's just so like out there and so full of energy. And we interviewed him on a Sunday, so he's had 3 days of this con to be completely exhausted and wore out.
And he's still bubbly.
Yeah, still bubbly, man. Still ready to go, still excited, man. So let's go ahead and check it out, man. See what the audience thinks here.
What's going on, Comic Book Jerk fans? It's Drac again with Keith Allen. Some of you guys might know him as the Murphy from Z Nation. So what's going on today, Keith?
Oh, you know, I'm just having a great time here at Lexicon Comic Con, meeting the fans and getting some zombie love, you know.
You know, I've got to say, you know, after seeing the end of season two, I got to say you're looking like you're in a hell of a lot better shape today in Lexington than you were at the end of that season.
I'm much more handsome in person.
So, anything you can tell us at all about season three?
It's going to get crazy. Yeah. You know, one thing is that Murphy is going to be on his own for a little bit. You know, he's branched off from the group and doing his own thing. He's tired of getting told what to do and where to go. So, you know, soon enough, although we will regroup back together and for a common cause about mid-season, I think. But
yeah. So, any more word on that, you know, at Z-Weed?
Oh, yeah, you know, talk to Doc. That's his department, you know.
All right, well, guys, we have Keith Allen here. He's a busy, busy man at Sunday. We're about to wrap up the con. Just want to say thank you and welcome to Kentucky, brother, and we hope to see you back again. Thank you.
Such a friendly, and nice man.
What I loved about this interview the most is he said, "Man, I've got enough time to do maybe a 2-3 minute interview, and you cut it in half for him. Like he was like, here's a 1-minute 14-second interview. It gets strictly there to the point, and like there's so much energy to it. Like he is just ready. And this is like the last day of the con, and we've got an hour before the con ends. It was like we're just walking past everybody and getting interviews like that, man. And as soon as he said, go talk to Doc, Doc was waiting. Doc was like, he was just standing over like ready to go, man.
But I want to bring up the fact that, you know, if you watch Z Nation, you know, his character Murphy, he's kind of a prick. And Keith Allen, the man himself, man, is a complete polar opposite of that. He's a really nice guy. So, you know, really enjoyed that interview with Keith Allen. But, yeah, we had Russell Hodgkinson, and I have a hard time saying that. I don't know why, who plays Doc on Z Nation. And, you know, he's basically the equivalent of the zombie apocalypse Tommy Chong, if you will. So he was really awesome, too.
Yeah, definitely, man. That was a fun interview, too, man, to have him. Like, he was into the interview, too, man. Like, it's like, are all these Z Nation crew, are they on the zombie weed? Like, everybody just has so much life, dude. It's just...
Hey, don't knock the Z weed.
Tell us about that Z-weed,
because
I know nothing about the
Z-weed. The Z-weed possibly has a cure for the zombie plague. So they're testing out these different strains. There's an episode in season 2 called Batch 47. And it's literally a greenhouse where the marijuana is compost from zombies themselves, and the zombies have turned into plant zombies. It's really far out, man. It's an awesome episode. They blow some of this batch 47 up a severed zombie head's nose, and the zombie looks at him and goes brains, which is a nod to the Return of the Living Dead. So, because that's what those zombies did, they ran around and went brains. Well,
I've got through the first season, but the second season, like, I don't think it's hit Netflix yet, has it?
Yeah,
has it hit Netflix? Oh man, it is time to totally catch up on that. But I thought Doc was really interesting, man, because, like, he's like the zombie version of Cheech and Chong, like, all rolled into one, man. And those glasses he wears, man, like, I mean, how can you go wrong with that, man? Let's check it out, dude. You ready?
Let's roll it, man.
Roll that beautiful.
What's up, guys? It's Drac again, comicbookjerk.com, 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention. I'm here with Russell Hodgkinson.
Very good.
Some of you guys might know him as Doc from the hit show on sci-fi, Z Nation. What's going on today, Russell?
Well, you know, it's just another day in Lexington, Kentucky, meeting the fans and really enjoying our time here at the Comic-Con. You know, just digging.
So can you give us just a little insight of what's in store for Doc in Season 3?
Well, I think you're going to find some more Z-weed in the picture, for sure. For those of you who don't know about the Z-weed, it's what you get when you grow marijuana using dead zombies as compost. And when the zombies get a hold of it, they get a little bit of consciousness comes back to them. It's a brilliant idea.
Right on. So, you know, talking to Russell again instead of Doc here. So tell us how you came about getting the role of Doc on Z Nation.
I just auditioned with everybody else in town, and they liked the way I smoked the weed. It was my air shaft scene when I'm getting high with the zombie. That was the scene. That was my audition monologue. So they liked the way that I did it, and the rest is history. Who knows?
See, kids, you can accomplish things from being a pothead.
That's right. There you go. It's possible.
All right. Well, this is Drac and Russell. Kicking it off, about to wrap up the 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention. Just want to say thank you, brother. Welcome
thank
to Kentucky.
You,
and
so
next time you're here, we might have to try some of that Kentucky Blue Bud.
Some of that, yeah, man. Some hot browns. I hear that's some good stuff, right? Some hot browns. Y'all heard that?
Right on.
Okay, man.
All right.
Dude.
Now.
What is brown weed? What is the brown weed?
Hot brown.
Hot brown. Oh, man. Like,
not really sure at all. But sure,
I have no clue if whatsoever when he was talking about.
If Doc from Z Nation says, "Hey man, let's go blow some trees," you know, and there's a handful of people out there that, you know, if I had an opportunity to smoke marijuana with, I really wouldn't care who knew about it or if it was even on video, and that would be Snoop Dogg, Tommy Chong, Willie Nelson, Russell Hodgkinson, and maybe like Jim Brewer or somebody, you know? So to me, hey, man, he's a cool guy. You know, I was saying earlier that Murphy was totally different than Keith Allen, but Russell and Doc, they're pretty much the same person.
Yeah, like they were so energized. Like, this is one of those things where it's like, wah, you know?
Right.
And, you know, it's so weird that you bring that up because, like, I don't know if you know this, but Jim Brewer was actually a part of the Clerks TV series. When they shot a pilot for the Clerks, they were going to do a TV series. They didn't have the rights for Jay and Silent Bob. But at this comic convention, it felt like it was the 6 degrees of Kevin Smith or something, dude.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like, it was so odd. It was like...
Everybody was affiliated, yeah, man. Mark Kidwell, comic book man.
We've known Mark Kidwell forever, man. Like, we've known Mark Kidwell since he was doing...
5 years now.
Yeah, since he started the... Was it 68?
68 comic, yeah.
Yeah, since he was doing the 68. And then, like, we was going to get an interview with him this year, man. And, like, he told me so much, like, amazing stuff that he had been doing. Like, he started doing the production art and the concept art for Tusk. And then he got to work on Yoga Hosers doing a character that I didn't even know exists, which I won't say anything about, because there's something way more than the Bratzies that is going to be cool. And then he's also doing some of the concept art for Moose Jaws. Like, I was like, this is the 6 degrees. Like, anybody in Hollywood has had a brush in with Kevin Smith. And now, officially, the Comic Book Jerk Show has worked with the comic book men, and there's the 6 degrees of Kevin Smith, dude. It is.
So tell us a little bit about the comic book man working with the comic book jerk.
Well, I'm telling you what, man. There come a point where you were doing the costume contest, and I didn't have anybody to hold the camera. I didn't have anybody to shoot interviews with, because apparently you got to have a selfie stick nowadays, and you got to use a selfie stick to do interviews, from what people said. But I walk up to their booth, and I'm like, yeah, you know, I was just kind of bummed out, just kind of chilling, talking to them. I was like, man, I've got to do these interviews, and I don't have anybody to hold the camera and. Or anybody do anything. And I looked at Ming. I was like, Ming, would you be interested in doing an interview? And then I looked at Mike. I was like, would you be interested in maybe me shooting an interview of you actually getting one of these artists or something like that? And we were going to do, I think we were going to do Neil Adams, but he wasn't there or something like that. But Ming was like, yeah, I'd be more than happy to hold the camera for you or something like that if you need to get an interview. It's like, no, even better, how about I put you on the camera and I'll hold the camera and you do some interviews with some random guests, random people. And there was this one instance where we went up to a couple people and they were geeking out. They were like, oh my God, this is Ming Chen. And Ming was like, let's do an interview. And they was, dude, it's just something that just
well, before you roll that, man, there was a really awesome interview that you did with Zapcic and Chen. And but what you don't see is the before the interview where we actually took shots of bourbon with them.
Oh yeah, they definitely poured us a shot of bourbon and stuff. It, you know, that was pretty cool because I'm sitting there drinking like apparently Mike Zapcic doesn't drink, and even at his panel they did a Kentucky bourbon panel where some of the Power Rangers and the comic book men got together, and Mike actually had a stunt drunk for his, pretty much basically a stunt liver as Jared called it, which was really funny because. Every time that somebody would ask him a question, they would have to take a drink of this bourbon. So it was like, question, bourbon, question. And it was a raunchy panel, dude. There was questions asked like you would not believe. Like, you know, who would you want to fight, fuck, kill, or marry? You know, stuff like that.
Oh, there's another F-bomb.
That makes us rated R, everybody. So let's go ahead and get this interview and check it out.
What's up? It's the Comic Book Jerk at the 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention with Ming Chen.
Mike Zapcic.
That's right, and we're going to talk a little bit about whatever you guys want to talk about.
Pop culture, comics, Star Wars.
Whatever.
So, you know, the interesting thing about the comic book man was the first season was like an hour long, right. And then the next season was 30 minutes long. Was there any reason behind that? Or
I think, like all great comedies, Seinfeld, Cheers, The Cosby Show. Let's take out The Cosby Show. We don't talk about that. They're all half-hour comedies, and so they wanted it. They thought... You know, leave the audience wanting more.
Yeah.
So via a half hour, it feels like it goes really quick, and you know, you're left wanting more. I think it's a good strategy. I think, honestly, in my opinion, an hour long reality show should be like competition, like Amazing Race,
Survivor. Yeah, and you got more episodes.
Yeah. I'm gonna stop Ming right there. First off, you called us a comedy. What we have in common with those other shows is that they're good. We're not, and they're also scripted, and we're not.
don't ever forget that. I mean, when people come and they bring in stuff to the store, it is set up beforehand, but it's not a setup. There's no, we don't have a script that we read off of. You try telling Brian Johnson to say something, he'll tell you to go, are we rated R now?
You say whatever.
Exactly. He'll tell you to go fuck yourself. And he'll tell you how, and he'll tell you how he wants to see it. So that's what happens when you try to tell Brian Johnson something funny to say. So,
well, I also remember before the show even started that they had they were casting people. They were sending out like, hey, we're doing open castings, and then it just turned into people that it, like, there wasn't any open casting after that. Like,
no, it was us because we were just that damn good. So.
So how long have you guys been in the shop, like, technically?
I've been working with Kevin about 20 years. I wasn't in the shop initially, but I kind of wormed my way in. So, like, 10 years. Mike's been there for how long now?
I've been there for, I think it's going on almost 16 years. And I was a customer for 3 years before that. So, I've been around for a
while. What did you do beforehand?
I did graphic design, websites, and anything else Kevin needed. I was like, you need to go on a weed run?
Yeah.
I'll go get weed for you. You need rolling papers?
I read that on Internet Movie Database, but I didn't want to be like, well, you know, I read this on this, but, you know.
I tell you, that sounds like an offer, man. You offering to go for a weed run for everybody here?
We'll do it.
No.
Tweet him at MingChen37.
That's right.
Ming, go on a weed run for me.
What is the most, like, craziest moment you've had at the shop, though? Like, even if it's not been on the air, but, like, what's the craziest, like, thing somebody's brought in or, like, one of the craziest stories? Okay.
All right, here's what happened. We were filming a segment. I'm not going to tell you which one, but the young lady who was filming it with us was a little tipsy. She got a little stage fright and decided to have a couple of pops before she went on camera. She goes on camera, and it hits, and she is drunk talking to us, and she wet herself. So she peed her pants.
Did we ever see that on the DVD?
No, you'll never see that anywhere, and I would love it. I'd pay money to see that, wouldn't you?
Was you at the shop when that happened?
Yeah, I was there. Yeah, she peed her pants. It was the first time it's ever happened. But
like,
yeah.
did you have a pair of pants that you could offer, like some Deadpool, like, pants or, like, anything that you'd be like, well, we have these for 25 to 50.
Yeah, these are screen-worn Ryan Reynolds pants that you can put on, because I trust you not to piss these.
Now, we see Ming's eyes light up when stuff comes in the shop. Is there anything in particular that pops into the shop that you're just like, or has popped in, that you're just like, we have to get this, whether you get it or I get it, somebody's...
Anything G.I. Joe?
Yeah, all the time. Anything G.I. Joe. G.I. Joe is in my wheelhouse. I'm an 80s kid. G.I. Joe aircraft carrier. The USS flag came in. Like, I had to get it.
Yeah, I remember that episode.
Yeah. Because
I've watched it on Netflix like 20 times now. But, like, anything other than that that's not been on the air, like...
Anything Transformers. But, I mean, literally anything G.I. Joe, like, they'll call me. Because they don't want it.
What about you, Mike?
I bought a couple things from the shop, and, you know, when Walt's like, I don't really want to do this, but, you know, you guys go ahead, and that's one of the rules of the shop. If we want it for ourselves, just make sure that we don't want it for the shop first. So I've gotten a lot of stuff through the shop. I lost my comic collection in Sandy, so the shop's helped me put together, you know, a huge chunk of my collection.
Yeah, I wasn't going to down the podcast by bringing up the dramatic turn of events.
No, don't worry about that. I mean, hey, it's like a sandcastle. You knock it down, you build it right back up again.
How much of your collection have you actually recouped since then? Like, have you made a fair amount?
I'd say about half, yeah. And I made some upgrades. And we're all comic book collectors here, so we know there's never an end to your collecting. It's like, oh, I'm done. I've got everything I want, and I'll see you later, because they're always putting stuff out.
So what episode are you guys at currently on the podcast?
Ming, what?
We're at like 230?
Something like that, yeah. We do a podcast called I Sell Comics. 210. Great, 210.
Was this started like way before the show, or
yes,
like kind of?
Yeah, it started before the show, and yeah, we keep going. So.
And we actually have a new podcast out called Ming and Mike.
Wow. They're doing it upright, man. So what are you guys most excited about at the Lexington Comic Con this year?
Lexington? Man, you got some great guests here. We've got, for God's sake,
yeah.
Tony Kitaen.
Yeah, Tony Kitaen. We got Karen Ashley. We got Karen Gillan. We got the 5th, 6th, and 7th Doctor. Henry Winkler is one we're really excited about.
I was on a plane with Henry Winkler.
It was weird.
So when it comes to guests that come on to the comic book, man, like, Does anybody ever just show up just randomly? Like what is Stan Lee doing here just sitting here?
It was really weird. I got a call from Method Man from Wu-Tang. He's like, hey, it's Mike from Comic Book Man. I'm like, who the hell is this? He's like, it's Method Man from Wu-Tang. I'm like, no freaking way. So he called up. He wanted to buy something from, I couldn't sell it to him. It's part of our set design. It's a Legion of Superheroes clubhouse. He's like, I need that. I'm like, I can't help you, Method Man. It sucks. I wish I could. But, you know, you figure Walt be like, everything must go. I don't care. Let's
pull up the floor panel.
Some stuff is owned by AMC. Oh. Like, you know, part of Ming Soul.
Yeah. All of his soul?
Yeah. All of. I wanted to give him a little bit, so.
Yeah, a lot of the people we meet at cons, and we're like, hey, we would love to have you on the show. Would you ever consider coming on? And they have. Kevin Eastman, we got that way. Lou
Perez.
We got that way. I think Lou, not Lou, a bunch of other. Lou agreed to come on because we met him at a con. A lot of people.
Right now. You got any other cons coming up this year? I'm sure you do.
We got a bunch coming up. So,
how does that interfere with the filming of Comic Book Man opposed to the podcast and all that? How do you keep it all separated?
It doesn't. We film during the summertime, so it's like a 9-to-5 job. And us going out is usually on weekends, so it almost never interferes.
Is there ever nights that you're just like, we'll have to do the podcast from the hotel room because we've got to get the podcast out?
No, we usually do it in the mornings at the stash, and we do it during the week. So we can. Has it been really jammed in there? Yeah, it has. But, you know, we make it work.
You guys have any more crazy stories that you want to tell people that nobody's ever heard before, or any cool stuff that happened?
Listen to our podcast, mingandmike.com. We tell crazy stories literally every week.
Yeah. So there's no secrets here. So check out their podcast and check out thecomicbookjerk.com for more podcast in action as we get around the 2016 Lexington Comic and Toy Convention and having a drink with Ming and Mike.
So I wonder what days do they do their podcast? Because, I mean, you were around them a lot this weekend. So I could say you there may be a mention of you in there.
Well, early in the mornings, they usually do their podcast. And I think it's the same day every week. Because if you look on Stitcher and iTunes and all that, they're the same as our podcast. So they show up there and it shows them the days. So I think it's one day in the week they all get together and do that. But it's... You know, I tried to find the Mike and Ming show, but I couldn't find it. But I did find the I Sell Comics.
Well, look for the Ming and Mike show, because that's the way he said it. He didn't say Mike and Ming. He said Ming and Mike.
Well, whenever I was stuck in traffic, I listened to episode 210, which was actually pretty cool. So that actually kept me through. I had 3 hours in traffic, dude. And I think I managed to get through that episode and then another episode after it. So it was oh, man, this is actually really good. So whenever I spent time with them at the con, man, like getting those interviews was really cool. I was thinking, after I got done doing the interviews and Mike and Ming did their interviews, I was thinking, well, this whole Comic Book Jerk Show podcast has just turned into I Sell Comics, basically, because Ming did 3 really cool interviews, and I definitely want to show them off to the audience.
Let's see them, brother.
Well, before we,
because I haven't seen these yet.
Oh no, this is why you was at the costume contest, and I mean,
right? I was doing my thing.
All of these videos all these videos and audio segments that you're hearing, whether this turns into one of the podcasts, these are also the first time that me and you have got together and actually watched them or listened to them. So, you know, right. I said, I had no idea I had those glasses on my head, but man, it's just a really great experience. Let's check it out.
And from AMC's Comic Book Man, I'm here stopping anyone, the best of cosplay here in Lexington at the Lexington Comic and Toy Con. Dude, you're the embodiment of evil. You look amazing. How has your day been?
It's been pretty good.
Have you had to smack anybody down? Have you had to unleash that evil?
No, well, everybody just cowers and bows before me, so I don't have any problems.
Anyway, how many Captain Americas, though, have you had to defeat? Just put them in their place.
Well, I've seen one. But he ran. He was so scared. He just ran off.
Now I'm a old school. I saw the 1994 Captain America movie that was kind of barely released. You look way better than that Red Skull that was in that movie.
I'm the Red Skull from the first Avengers, the new movie.
Yeah, you're looking at me. How long did this take you? Did you mold and cast that mask? Is there a talent, someone super talented that you bought that mask from?
Well, I bought the mask from a company online, which the name eludes me right now, but everything else I made.
Yeah, it's amazing. You just look like pure evil.
Thank you.
Yes, I mean,
I do my best.
Yeah, in real life, I'm sure you're a great guy. Probably help old ladies across the street. But it's just that, you know, put that cosplay on, like everything, yeah. It just changes. you look great. Well, keep doing what you're doing. And I hope you're having a great day here at Lexington Comic and Toy Con.
All right, thank you. Hail Hydra.
Hail Hydra.
You know, I couldn't stop looking at the Catwoman in the background, though.
Yeah, that was a person we was going to get an interview with, but she had so many people around her, like, it was just almost impossible to get an interview. Like, she had people just smothering around her, just wanting to take pictures and do interviews and all that stuff. So it was one of those moments of, like, I don't think we're going to get an interview with her. Now something that I found really interesting is the couple that we have next. The couple that we have next, we're just talking to Reggie, one of the Power Rangers, who actually filled in and he took over in Power Rangers Turbo near the end of that season. And then he went on to Power Rangers in Space and stuff. But Ming wanted to go say hi to him, so we stopped by to talk to him for a second before we left. And the next thing you know, he's got a ton of just awesome, like, people just wanting to talk to him. So we actually got into there and, you know, actually interviewed him and stuff. So let's check that out.
Right on.
What's up, everybody? This is Ming Chen from Comic Book Man. We're here at the Lexington Comic and Toy Con.
Yeah.
What's up, my friend? You were working with the Power Rangers all day.
Yeah, my name is Brandon Benfield. This is my wife, Katie.
Hi.
Now, what's that like? Are they pain in the butt? Like, are they smooth? Are they smooth as they appear on the show?
They're smooth, man. They're awesome. You know, I've been a fan for 23 years now, and so it's been awesome to go from a childhood fan to a grown-up, like, adult volunteer working with them for the past 2 years. So
is it hard to rein in? Like, I know you're a fan. Like, you know, you see these guys.
Yeah.
You know, the helmets are off. The costumes are off. But still, like, they have an aura.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I think it's really cool when I meet a new one. Like, this is my first time meeting Reggie over here, but there's a few that I see a lot. So it's more like friendship rather than, like, just the kind of the fandom has worn off, and it's more like just we hang out all weekend. So
yeah, they're regulars. They don't, you know, they're not. They don't kick ass. They kick ass.
Right. Oh, they always kick ass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but not all the time. And, yeah. You know, it's cool to, you know, let's kick back, drink a beer, and
sure.
And have fun. And these guys do a lot of cons, like, almost every weekend.
They do,
so
yeah.
They're,
yep.
You know, you got to make the most of it. You got to have fun.
Yep, all over the country. You know, we're always traveling. Whenever they give me a call if they need social media stuff going on, or, you know, every time they got a con around the Midwest, sometimes my wife will come, or either, you know, we'll help out at the convention. So it's always a good time whenever the Rangers are in town. It's always a good time to have comic book men in town as well.
You guys are
making your way to the Midwest, so that's awesome.
Yeah, I'm not a Ranger, though. What I've noticed, I go to a lot of cons, and I'm like, man, it's good to be a Ranger.
It's absolutely great to be a Ranger. They're all sweethearts, though. They love every single fan that comes out. Personal attention. They love all the stories. This is my second time handling, and I've noticed every single one of them just a pure love of the fan and the stories and the life-changing stuff that this show did for a lot of us growing up and even to this day. And some of the nicest people you'll ever meet are the Rangers.
That's awesome. Thank you guys so much. I hope you had a great day. We got another day to go. Like, this is, I don't want it to end. I don't want it to end.
No, Sundays are fun days, so you guys got to come out for Sunday.
Yeah. It's morphin' time, everybody.
It's morphin' time.
That's one of those interviews where the fans are so freaking excited that they're getting to talk to Ming. Like it was
right.
Like one of those things where it's like, oh my goodness, it's Ming, it's Ming. I really wish you could have been there, man. Like, it was one of those moments. It's like, hey.
Well, you know, I'm under contract with Lexington Comic and Toy Convention to do the costume contest, so I had to go earn my keep.
Yeah, sometimes you got to earn that keep. Got one more interview with Ming, and this was a pretty cool one. This was the first interview that we actually did. And for some reason, I didn't plug up my microphone. I don't know what it was, but it was just such a quick interview. We just grabbed somebody real quick, and by the time the interview was halfway over, I was like, I forgot to plug my microphone in. So I thought this one was really cool, though, man, because everybody was good sports about it and everything. So let's check it out.
Hello, everybody. This is Ming Chen from AMC's Comic Book Men. I love Comic Cons. I love conventions. I love being here. But what I really love is cosplay. I stopped you here. You look amazing.
Thank you.
You were just like everything. Anytime I play Mario Kart or Smash Brothers, Bowser, you look amazing. You look amazing as well. How's everything going? Are you having a great convention?
Yes, it's been amazing so far.
And you said this is your second one ever?
My second interview. Somebody just stopped me earlier. Can I interview you? Sure, but only if you can find me Princess Peach.
That's tough. That's a tough order. You guys have you been getting stopped like every 5 feet?
Yes. Yeah, it's hard to get through. Because I keep almost hitting people with my sword, and they're like, can I have a picture? And I'm like, hold on, let me put it up and not get someone in the head with it. It's been crazy.
It's a hazard, but it's an occupational hazard. It happens.
It is. I mean, it happens when you're the commander-in-chief of scene. Sometimes you just have to carry the luggage.
Yeah, and it happens when you're a badass. I mean, it's just gonna happen. So get used to it, my friend.
Thank you.
I just thought, how long did it take you to make this?
I made this skirt last night.
Like, literally last night, you were sewing last night?
Yeah, I was cutting the fabric and sewing last night. But my shell took probably about 3 weeks because I sewed it by hand.
Like, this is all, everything here is like all self-made.
I talked to you earlier, and
self-made.
I just got just the backpack, and I was like, oh my god, you're so squishy. Wait, that's the shell.
Yeah, but that's great craftsmanship. And it seems to be a theme with cosplayers, it's always last minute, but it always comes out amazing.
It's because I'm a procrastinator by nature.
Yeah, I mean, thank you for elevating, it's an art. It's definitely an art, thank you for elevating the art. We were by Yaya Hunt, who's, she's doing a thing with Jordan Fabrics. It's still like, it's mainstream now. It's like, this is culture. This is like everything right now.
I am super excited about Joanne Fabrics carrying cosplay fabric now.
They're amazing. Have you touched them?
Yes.
You touch the normal fabric and you're like, oh, I don't want to wear that. And then you touch the Yaya Han fabric and you're like, must have it on me. It's fabulous.
Yeah, I keep telling people, back when I'm old, back when I was going to cons, you'd have like one or two guys in like a cardboard Wolverine outfit, and they looked a little uncomfortable because no one else was cosplaying. Like here, it's like, it's literally one every like three people.
Yeah.
But that's thanks to you guys. You know, you guys have the courage, the artistry, the skill to put these costumes together and come and wear it out like in here. Like if you're not in cosplay, you're like, you're the one that's you're the one that's like not out of place, I think, if you're not in cosplay now.
I like actually walking through and seeing everybody, like their smiles light up and they're like, ah, it's Bowser! It's Bowser, she's getting married, but she's not because Princess Peach is gone.
Yeah, you guys are amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And thank you for elevating the game. Thank you for being here at Lexington Comic and Toy Con. And thanks for hanging out with me. Like, it's an honor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That just on the point interview, I think that was the warm-up interview that started it off. That warmed it up for, hey, let's go ahead and knock it out. So, yeah, it's the Comic Book Men basically took up the Comic Book Jerk Show. It took it over. It was magical.
That's right.
So I think that's about all the time we have for this week's episode. Unless you got anything you want to shout out, anything you want to talk about, cool stories from the con, or anything interesting happening to Fat Daddy Drag?
I know. Had a great con. It's always the year that I look forward to the most. And by the time it's over with, it's always the weekend. Let me start that over. It's always the weekend that I look forward to the most in the year. But when it gets here, it's always the weekend that I want to be over with as fast. Because as much fun as I have, it does wear me out. But no, had a great, great Comic-Con this year. Cannot wait for 2017. I'll definitely be there. I'm pretty sure that the Comic Book Jerk will be there. So make sure you're there as well.
Dude, I'm telling you, when it comes to these cons, for me, it is, I know that it's going to be a jam-packed weekend where I'm going to drive 2.5 hours every single day for the next 3 days because I never can get a hotel room in time. And it's also going to be one of those moments where I'm stressed out. I'm like, I've got to do all this work, and I need to get all this work done. And I do the best that I can, but since it was this year, we kind of laid back a little bit. You know, we let everything flow the way it should have flowed. And,
well, you know, I had my kids with me, too, and it was their first con ever. So yeah. I brought all three of my girls, including the little baby. So, you know, they definitely, you know, wanted their daddy around for that experience. And it got me being cool again. You know, I have a 13-year-old daughter, and, you know, I haven't been cool for a long time as far as she's concerned. But when she checked it out, that daddy became cool again. So, you know, that was another really awesome experience for me.
Now, just to let everybody know that we do have a Funko Pop trading night coming up on March the 26th, and this will be the day after the release of Batman vs. Superman, so we will be doing a live stream, if possible. We're hoping to do a live stream from this Funko Pop vinyl event. And
that's right, and it's going to be hosted at Moonlight Game Center in Frankfort, Kentucky.
That's right. And hopefully, after this event, we may have the Derby City Con if we can work everything out, and even before that, hopefully we'll be able to get you guys some great footage from Scarefest, one of our favorite events that we have. And we've missed it the past year because we both had different schedules and stuff. But we're back.
Right.
We're back on the same schedule, so we'll be able to get some awesome footage from Scarefest, possibly do some interviews with some of the horror. That's your thing. This, like, Scarefest is Fat Daddy Drag's con. Like, I'm the comic jerk, so Comic Cons is my thing. Horror and Scarefest is Fat Daddy Drag's thing. So hopefully, if you like the show, tune in to our podcast. And, you know, coming up soon, we'll get back on a regular schedule, bi-weekly podcast or weekly podcast. But we might put these up, you know, just as fillers, just for you guys to actually listen to. Because I know a lot of people have been asking, when are you going to start doing podcast again? Because when I work out or whenever I'm driving, I want to listen to the podcast. I can't watch the videos. So, you know, this is an added bonus. We'll throw our videos on the podcast for you guys to see and get everything going for you. But definitely check, if you're in the Kentucky area, definitely check out next week's Fun Time events, because we're definitely going to try to do a live podcast around 4 o'clock Eastern Pacific time. You can check out our podcast basically live on the air.
Right on.
You know, usually we pre-record these and post them the next day, but this will be a live podcast, so anything can happen.
That's right.
So wrapping up, what time is it, Drac?
Yo, man, I think it's time to first of all, before you do that, you might want to stop. We'll kick that music then.
Go ahead and say what you're going to say, Drac. We'll talk on the top of it.
The Comic Book Jerk Show is brought to you by SnapPal.com and BigOldBoxOfStuff.com. And we're also proud supporters of the Lexington Con and Toy Convention and the Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness.
That's right. Say it 3 times, 4 times fast.
The Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. The Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. The Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness. The Kentucky Funko League of Awesomeness.
That's right. It's time to sit back and watch a
Comic Book Jerk Show.
That's right.
We're out, though.
We're idiots.
We're out, though.